I myself am Gunakar, Assistant Professor of Zoology, Government Degree College, Siddipet, Telangana State. Today, let us discuss prion blood vascular system or circulatory system. Before going into the details of blood vascular system or circulatory system of prion, let us have a look at the systematic position of the prion. Prion belongs to the phylum Arthropoda because of having jointed legs. Prawn, it belongs to the subphylum Mandibulata because it has antennae and mandibles. It belongs to the class Crustacea because of having gills, green glands and two pairs of antennae and biramous appendages and aquatic arthropod. It belongs to the subclass Malacostraca because having a large body of 19 segments and each segment is having having appendages. It belongs to the order Decapoda because of the presence of 5 pairs of biramous walking legs. It belongs to the genus Palaemon as it is having the antennules, immovable rostrum with teeth. Then it belongs to the genus Palaemon and species Malcolmsoni. Sometimes it is also called as Macrobrachium Malcolmsoni. Let us have a look at the basic features of blood vascular system of the prion. Blood vascular system is regarded as open type in prion, in contrast to the closed type of blood vascular system that is present in the annelids. Then what is open type and what is closed type? I think you might have known that closed system of blood vascular system or circulatory system means the blood always flows through closed tubes called as blood vessels. It is completely closed tubes are present. Throughout the closed tubes, blood flows within the tubes. It never comes out. Only when injury takes place, then only the blood comes out. Until and unless injury is there, the blood won't come out. So the blood always flows within the tube-like structures called blood vessels, that is called closed circulatory system. Whereas prion, blood vascular system is open type. The blood flows in open sinuses or cavities within the blood. So that's why it is called as open type. And though there are some arteries are present, some blood vessels are present, mostly the blood flows in the open sinuses and cavities. Though arteries are present, there are no arterioles, that is branches of arteries are not there and veins are completely absent, capillaries are also completely absent. That's why just because of the presence of arteries cannot gives it a closed type of circulatory system. So it is considered as open type of circulatory system. Now, the spaces, just now we are discussing the spaces are open cavities that are present in the prion and otherwise and other arthropods, you can say generally, they are the spaces without proper wall and which are filled with blood. Hence, they are called blood lacunae or blood sinuses. And some of the arteries it possesses, though. And these arteries open into spaces in muscles and visceral organs. And along with the sinuses, body cavity or coelom is filled with the blood, hence it is called as hemocoel. So the coelom in arthropods in general, prion in particular, is called as hemocoel. The original coelom is restricted to only excretory organs or gonads. It is the original coelom, or true coelom is limited to gonads and excretory organs only. And as I said earlier, veins and capillaries are completely absent in the case of prion. Now, let us have a look at what are the main blood vascular system. Prion of blood vascular system includes what? It includes generally a heart. Main part of the blood vascular system is heart. Then heart, pericardium, are pericardial sinus, otherwise it's called dorsal sinus, arteries, blood sinuses are blood lacunae, blood channels, and as well as blood. So we will discuss the prion blood vascular system under these heads. Let us start with the heart. So prion heart, what is the specialty of the prion heart? Let us see. Prion heart is a muscular, as like other hearts of other animals are also muscular, because it is a pumping organ. That's why heart, prion heart is also a muscular organ, and it is triangular in structure, whereas its apex directs anteriorly. Its apex directs anteriorly. That means the sharp portion facing anteriorly, and the broad base facing posteriorly. Now you can have a look at this figure. In this figure, you can see its broad base. Broad base, you can see here. So the broad base is this one, and the apex is this one. So apex is facing forward, that means anteriorly, and the base backward or posteriorly. So this is the structure of the heart, or shape of the heart. Almost it is perfectly triangular in shape, whose apex is facing anteriorly and base posteriorly. Then it is, where it is located? It is located in the hemocoelomic chamber called pericardium. There is a chamber or separate cavity like structure is there. So that cavity or the chamber is called as pericardium, is called as pericardium or pericardial sinus or dorsal sinus, as it is located in the dorsal, just below the thorax, that is just below the carapace or thorax, it is located. It lies beneath the dorsal wall of the thorax, and pericardial septum is present, which is lying above the hepatopancreas, as is its floor. That means the heart is present within the pericardium. Heart is present within the pericardium. Say, let us say, for example, pericardium is like this. So the heart is present like this. So, and it forms a floor. This total pericardium forms a floor. This is the floor of the pericardium, and this floor of the pericardium, it is called pericardial septum. It lies above the hepatopancreas. Here the hepatopancreas will be there. So this is the floor, and this is the pericardium or pericardial sinus, and this is the heart. So it is looking like this. So now pericardial septum is its floor. Pericardial septum is its floor, and then this septum lies above the hepatopancreas. So it is its floor. Then three strands, where, how it is stay in the pericardium. It stays fixed in the pericardium. Heart stays fixed in the pericardium with the help of three muscular strands. And these strands, of course, musculars and fibrous tissue is present. And these strands help the heart to fix in its position. Then these strands are called one cardiopyloric strand, which connects the apex of the heart to the pyloric stomach, and two lateral strands. They start from the lateral sides. Each lateral sides are either the two lateral sides of the heart to the thoracic wall. So these three strands of fibrous tissue keep the heart in its place firmly. Then its thick wall has five pairs of valvular apertures called ostia, and they are named. There are ostia or apertures are present in the heart, and these apertures of the heart are valvular. That means they are provided with valves. They allow the blood in one direction only. That is, one direction means from the pericardium to the heart only, but not in the reverse order. So what are those five pairs of ostia, let us have a look. First one is the one pair of dorsal ostia, one pair of dorsal ostia, one pair of ventral ostia, one pair of posterior ostia, one pair of anterolateral ostia, one pair of posterolateral ostia. So one is dorsal, ventral, posterior, and anterolateral and posterolateral. Let us have a look in the figure. Okay, now see here you can see small apertures. One aperture, see, this is the dorsal aperture, these black color portions, this is the dorsal, that means mid dorsal. They are mid dorsally, that means mid dorsally on either side of the central position. Then those are the dorsal apertures or dorsal ostia, and this is ventral side. This is ventral side. So ventral side showing two ventral apertures like this, two, and then two posterior ostia. They are present here, here one, here one, on either side of the posterior mouth on the base posterior ostia, and then one anterolateral. See here, this is here, one more, two anterolateral and two posterolateral. Two posterolateral will be here, you can say posterior. See, the posterolateral will be lying itself. Here you can say posterolateral. One is showing there, other side one be one will be one. So totally dorsal ostia, ventral ostia, posterior ostia, anterolateral ostia, posterolateral ostia. There are five pairs of valvular ostia present in the heart. They are allowing the blood, they allow the blood from the pericardium to enter into the heart only, but not in the reverse side. But what is present inside the heart cavity is a sponge like, it is sponge like and filled with numerous muscle fibers, and blood is also present inside the heart. Next, prone arteries after heart and pericardium. Let us see the arteries. Prone has many types of arteries. Now let us have a look at this. So first of all, for example, median ophthalmic artery, antennary arteries. So like that, many arteries are present. Let us see one by one. First of all, median ophthalmic artery. What is, where it is present? Median ophthalmic artery. So the first median ophthalmic artery, it is single and it arises from the apex of the heart. You can see this is the heart, you can see this is the heart. So from the apex of the heart, it runs forward mid dorsally. This is the median thoracic, median ophthalmic artery. It arises from the apex of the heart. It runs forward mid dorsally along the renal sac to the head region. Up to the head region, it goes, and where it joins the two antennary arteries. Here, one antennary artery is coming like this, and other antennary artery is coming like this. So here, the median ophthalmic artery runs mid dorsally to the head region along the renal sac, and then where it joins the two antennary arteries above the esophagus. Here somewhere the esophagus is present, so above the esophagus it joins the two antennary arteries, forming a loop like structure. Now coming to the antennary arteries. These antennary arteries are a pair. One pair of antennary arteries are present. They also starts from the heart apex only, and one on each outer side of the median ophthalmic. See, this is the ophthalmic just now we have seen. So one on outer side, one each on outer side, this one and this one. These two are antennary arteries, and each antennary artery runs forward somewhat obliquely. See, somewhat obliquely it runs forward, and then passing along the outer border of the mandibular muscle. Here mandibular muscle are present, and it sends a pericardial branch. It sends a pericardial branch to the pericardium. See, this is the pericardial branch. It's the pericardial branch sending pericardial branch to supply to the pericardial wall or pericardium, and then a gastric branch to the stomach. So this is the gastric branch, each one sending gastric branch to the stomach also, and then a mandibular branch to the mandibular muscle. This is the mandibular branch, this is the mandibular branch, and sending to the mandibular muscle. Then it bifurcates into a dorsal branch and a ventral branch. See here, after mandible, so what happens is this each antennary artery, it bifurcates. So here it is bifurcating like this, and here also it is bifurcating like this. So this bifurcation gives the ventral branch further branches to supply the antennule. See, you can see here the ventral branch. This is the ventral branch, and this ventral branch is again dividing into three smaller branches. See, so each one, that means supply the one supply to the antennule, the antenna, and the renal organ. I repeat, here after supplying to the mandibular muscles, each antennary branch divides into two. One is dorsal, the other is ventral. So each ventral branch on either side again divides into three. One supplies to the antenna, another supplies to the antennule, and the other to the renal organ. Then let us go to the dorsal branch of the antennary artery. Dorsal branch sends an optic artery. See here, dorsal branch sends an optic artery here, optic artery, and then it meet the fellow of the opposite sides. It meet the fellow of the opposite sides means after sending optic artery, then it meets with the other on that side. So this side meets. So two dorsal branches, they meet. Again, not only the two counterparts, the two parts meet, two fellow parts meet, but they also meet with the median ophthalmic artery. See here also, median ophthalmic artery forming a circular loop-like artery. This is loop-like artery, and this loop-like artery formed by two dorsal arteries, two dorsal branches of the antennary arteries, and as well as the median ophthalmic artery. And this loop-like artery is called as circulus cephalicus. It is called circulus cephalicus artery. And this circulus cephalic artery, it gives off a pair of rostral arteries to the rostrum. This is the here rostral arteries to the, this is circular cephalicus, and each one gives rostral artery. Now, coming to the, so antennary artery just now I have seen completed. Then see, circular cephalicus, it is forming a loop like artery, it supplies to the rostrum. So next, hepatopancreatic arteries, hepatic artery or hepatopancreatic artery it is also called. It is one pair. Hepatopancreatic artery is one pair. Let us see. So this is the this one. So this is the hepatopancreatic artery or hepatic artery, and they arise from the heart ventrolaterally and on one on each side just behind the antennary. Just now we have seen these are the antennary. So on just behind the antennary arteries, one on either side ventrolaterally, one hepatopancreatic artery, another hepatopancreatic artery, they arise from the apex of the heart only, and they go downwards into the hepatopancreas. They enter downwards into the hepatopancreas, within which they divide and subdivide. After entering into the hepatopancreas, they divide enormously like this. After entering into the hepatopancreas, not here, after entering into the hepatopancreas, they divide and subdivide. That's all. Now coming to the median posterior artery. Next one is median. See, this is the median posterior artery. What happens to the median posterior artery, as it is a single one? So where it is present, let us see. As I said just now, median posterior artery, it is a short but very stout median and posterior artery. Median posterior artery, it arises posteroventral surface of the heart. See, here this is the heart, you can see posteroventral. So here this is the posterior part and ventral part. So from the posterior ventral part, one artery arises. This is one artery and goes along the mid-dorsal line, posterior towards the posterior side, towards the posterior side, and before it goes posteriormost part, then it bifurcates into two like this. It bifurcates into two like this. So this bifurcation gives two arteries. One is supraintestinal artery. So here this is the artery, median posterior artery, and immediately median posterior artery bifurcates like this. So the one goes to the posterior part, which is called supraintestinal artery. This is the supraintestinal artery, and the other, which goes downwards, which is called sternal artery. This is the sternal artery. So supraintestinal artery and sternal artery. Then what happens to the supraintestinal artery, which is also called dorsal abdominal artery? This is the supraintestinal artery or dorsal abdominal artery, and this artery runs backwards along the dorsal surface of the intestine up to the hindgut. See here, somewhere hindgut is present here. So up to the hindgut, it presents, supplies, it runs. Then it supplies blood to the midgut and the dorsal abdominal muscle. It supplies blood to the midgut and dorsal abdominal muscles. Then what happens to the sternal artery? Just now we have seen this is the sternal artery, which goes downwards after deviating from the artery by bisecting from the median posterior artery. See, the sternal artery is stoutest in the body. It is the stoutest or strongest in the body. It runs downwards and forwards. See, it runs downwards and as well as forwards like this. Then through the hepatopancreas. Just now we have discussed the heart. The heart is present above the hepatopancreas. That's why its sternal artery goes down, means it goes through the hepatopancreas, and then it pierces. It pierces means it makes a hole. It makes a hole through. It makes a hole. That means it is not making a hole. Already an aperture-like structure is present in the ventral thoracic ganglionic mass. See here. Here you can see the ventral thoracic ganglionic mass is present here. It's already having an aperture-like structure, and through the aperture, through that aperture, this sternal artery moves or goes downwards, and then to reach the ventral side, it reaches the ventral side, and then after reaching the ventral side, what happens? It divides into two. See, the sternal artery, after moving through the hepatopancreas and ventral thoracic ganglionic mass, it moves, it reaches the ventral part, then it divides into two. One goes forwards and one goes backwards. Okay, so this is the one is ventral thoracic branch, which runs anteriorly. See, this is one branch going forward, which is called ventral thoracic branch, and the other, which is going backward, ventral abdominal branch. Very easy, very simple to understand or remind. That means the ventral sternal artery divides into two, one going forward, one going backward. The one or the branch which going forward is called as ventral thoracic artery, and the one which going backward is called ventral abdominal artery or branch. The ventral thoracic branch runs anteriorly up to the mouth. This is it goes, and then up to the mouth it runs ventrally along the midventral line, then supplying on running up to the mouth, it supplies the sternal region. Sternal region means chest region or thoracic region, and then the first three pairs of walking legs, it supplies the blood to the first three pairs of walking legs, and then maxillae and the maxillary. So these are all supplied by the ventral thoracic branch. And the ventral abdominal branch that runs backward, just now we have seen ventral abdominal branch, it runs posteriorly up to the anus and supplies blood to the ventral abdominal region and last two pairs of legs, the pleopods and the hindgut. So this is about the details of all the arteries. So totally there are four main arteries. One is median ophthalmic artery, the two antennary artery, a pair of antennary arteries, three hepatic artery, and fourth median posterior artery. Now coming to the next slide. Now the blood sinuses. We have already discussed that sinuses means open cavities. The blood flows into the open cavities. So what are these open cavities or open places or lacunae? Let us see. So just now we have seen the blood that is coming out of the heart flows into the arteries, different types of arteries and supplying to different organs. Just now we have discussed. Now these arteries and their branches, I have told you arteries are giving out simply branches but not arterioles and capillaries are absent. So arteries, after entering into the respective organs, they give out the branches and then supply the blood to various organs. Then they not only are supplying branches, then these arteries open into the blood sinuses of hemocele. All they open into the blood sinuses of the hemocele, open spaces. We discussed already open spaces of the hemocele. Then all these sinuses meet to form a pair of ventral sinuses. All these sinuses meet to form a ventral sinuses, and there are a pair of ventral sinuses lying below the hepatopancreas. And these ventral sinuses communicate at several places. They are not different. That means they are not completely different, but they communicate with each other at many places. The two ventral sinuses communicate with each other at various places. And these ventral sinuses, they receive blood from all parts and send it to pericardium after aeration. After aeration again, they send it to pericardium. That means with these ventral sinuses, how they helpful in aeration, let us see. So next is blood channels. See the blood channels. The blood channels are, what are the blood channels and how many types of blood channels? Let us see. The channels are lacunar tubes without proper walls. These are the lacunar tubes. Lacunar tubes means, the lacunae means open cavities. They are sometimes tube-like. They become sometimes tube-like and without any proper walls. So that's why this cannot be called as blood vessels also. They are not similar to the blood vessels. And there are two types of blood channels are present. Mainly two types of blood channels are present. One type of blood channels are afferent branchial channels and the other is efferent branchial channels. Where they are present, let us see. See, there are totally six afferent branchial channels are there and again six efferent branchial channels are there. So you can count them on this figure. In this figure, you can count them. So totally here black color structures are present here. So here in the middle portions, for example, these are the middle portions. So except these middle portions, on that side 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 are there. So here also 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 are there. So these are the afferent blood channels and these are the efferent blood channels. They are connected with each other through gill roots. Here these are the gill roots. In the middle, gill roots are present. So how they are present? Now these afferent blood channels, they start from the blood sinuses. Just now we have seen blood sinuses, and from the blood sinuses, they collect all the venous blood from blood sinuses and they communicate with the efferent blood vessels, efferent blood channels like here. But they communicate. In between these two, there is a gill roots are present. So the blood, when it goes, blood when goes from the afferent blood channels to the efferent blood channels, it flows through the gills. We know that the gills are main respiratory organs in the case of the prana. So when the blood flows, or venous blood, when the venous blood flows through the gills, it will be aerated. That means the gaseous exchange takes place, oxygen comes in and carbon dioxide will be given out. So this respiration or this gaseous exchange takes place, so the blood will become aerated. So what happens? Let us see. Just now we have seen there are six afferent branchial channels. They carry venous blood from ventral sinuses to the gills for aeration, and they enter the gills through the gill roots. Just now I have told you. Now the channels run upwards along the inner side of the lateral thoracic wall and enter the gills through their gill roots. The first channel feeds or sends blood to the podobranch and two arthrobranchs, and remaining five channels, they feed the blood or they give or they send the blood to the five pleurobranchs. So totally 8 gills are present, we know, in the prana. 1 podobranch, a pair of 2 arthrobranchs, 5 pleurobranchs. These are the 8 pairs of, a pair of podobranchs, 2 pairs of arthrobranchs and 5 pairs of pleurobranchs. We know that these are the gills, which are respiratory organs in the prana. So the first afferent branchial channel, it picks up the venous blood from the ventral sinus, then it sends that into the podobranch and two pairs of arthrobranchs. Whereas remaining five channels, they pick up the venous blood and then send it to the five pairs of pleurobranchs through the gill roots. Then in the gills, blood circulates through the three main channels. One is lateral longitudinal channel, marginal channel, and median longitudinal channel. When we discuss the respiratory system, we have already looked what is happening there. So where the lateral longitudinal channel will be like this, a pair of lateral longitudinal channel, and then two lateral longitudinal channels are connected by transverse channels like this. Okay, and then there is a median longitudinal channel like this. So afferent channel or afferent branchial channel, they open into the here somewhere into the transverse channel first. So then the venous blood from the afferent branchial channel enter into the transverse channel, then they flow through the lateral longitudinal channel. Somewhere here they are connected to gills. Here the marginal channels are present here like this. The marginal channels are present here. The gill roots are present. So when they enter into the, from the lateral longitudinal channel, the blood enters into the marginal channels, then it flows like this, and then coming to the, these marginal channels are connected to the median longitudinal channel. So this median longitudinal channel, again it is connected to efferent branchial channels. Okay, so from the afferent branchial channel, it enters into the transverse channels. These transverse channels connects two longitudinal blood channels. Two longitudinal channels are connected to marginal channels. These marginal channels are again pours its blood to the median channel. So when the blood flows through these three channels, that is longitudinal channel, marginal channel and median longitudinal channel, then these three are present in the gills. So that's why these three are collectively called branchial channels, and that's why when the blood flows through this, here the respiratory gases exchange takes place, oxygen will be absorbed, and at the place carbon dioxide will be given out, so the blood will become aerated or purified. Now this purified blood or aerated blood from the median longitudinal channel, it is collected by six efferent branchial channels. So these are the six efferent branchial channels. So six efferent branchial channels here we can see. These are the six efferent branchial channels are present. So these are the six efferent branchial channels. These are the six afferent branchial channels. So these six efferent branchial channels, they collect the blood and then they supply to the pericardial sinus or pericardium. Now, so we have seen that all parts of the blood vascular system of the prana. Now let us discuss blood of prana before going to the circulation of blood in the prana. So blood of prana is colorless. It is colorless, thin watery fluid. It is thin watery fluid and colorless also. Why it is colorless? Is there any blood pigment is there? No, it is respiratory pigment is present, which is called hemocyanin. Copper containing metallic ion in this hemocyanin is copper. So copper containing hemocyanin is present, which is generally blue color, which gives the blood bluish color. But as these hemocyanin is dissolved in the plasma, so that's why the blood is colorless. The blood is colorless because it is dissolved in the plasma and there are no RBCR present. And what is present then? Then they present only leukocytes are present. These leukocytes are amoeboid in shape. That's why they are called as amoeboid corpuscles. Then they flow in the blood. The respiratory pigment is hemocyanin, in which metallic ion is copper. And it is dissolved in the plasma, not in the RBC, because RBC are not there. Then hemocyanin becomes blue when combined with oxygen. So it combines, when combined with oxygen, it becomes blue. So before combining with the oxygen, that is when it is combining with carbon dioxide or having impure blood, it is colorless. So whenever the respiratory gases exchange take place, whenever the oxygen is absorbed, then it becomes bluish in color. Then what happens, what is the function of the blood, that is plasma? So plasma transports food, plasma transport oxygen, plasma transports carbon dioxide from the cells to the outside, and then the waste material, that is nitrogenous waste or other wastes, are also collected from the desired organs, collected from the organs, and then sent to the respective places. And food, oxygen and carbon dioxide are also sent to the respective organs. Then what is the specialty of this blood of prana is it has remarkable clotting properties. That means it coagulates whenever it is coming out of the sinuses or arteries. So how? When any appendage is removed forcibly, the blood clots very fastly immediately, and wound is sealed at once. This remarkable power of coagulation helps the prana to heal itself. So whenever an organ is removed, or you pluck it, say for example a leg, if you pluck it from the prana, then you can't see any blood that oozes out, because as soon as the appendage is removed from the or plucked off, then it immediately the clot happens at the place of wound, then the wound is sealed completely at once. Now coming to the course of blood circulation in prana. So we have seen so far the details of the blood vascular system, what is present, the blood vascular system of prana, what it includes. See, heart, pericardial sinus or pericardium or dorsal sinus, then blood arteries, then the sinuses and the blood channels. So now we come to the course of blood circulation. So blood circulation, it starts from the heart. Let us start from the heart and come to up to the heart. The heart, by means of its rhythmic contractions, as we have earlier discussed, that the heart is a muscular organ, triangular organ. So because of the muscular organ, it pumps the blood then it by rhythmic contractions, and the forces the blood through the arteries first. So you can see here the blood from the heart forces into the arteries. So these are the arteries, various types of arteries. Just now it is represented by a single tube. Through the arteries, the blood passes to all parts of the body. Then, before being returned to the heart, the blood is distributed to the gills. So here, let us say these are the blood lacunae or blood sinuses, where all the blood visceral organs are present. Now here, the blood is again come to the heart. So before coming into the heart, it goes through the gills. So let us say here the gills will be present. So again, the blood will be collected by venuses. See, the ventral venuses are we have discussed this. The two venuses are present, ventral venuses, and two ventral venuses, they communicate with each other at various places, and these ventral venuses then they send the blood to the afferent branchial channels. So these are the afferent branchial channels. And then these afferent branchial channels, just now we have discussed, they send the blood, they are connected to the gill roots with the gills. They are connected to the gills through gill roots. So through the gill roots, the afferent branchial channels are connected to transverse connectives of the lateral longitudinal channel. And these transverse connectives, they carry the blood to the lateral longitudinal channels. From the lateral longitudinal channels, the blood flows to the marginal channels, and from the marginal channels, the blood enters into the median longitudinal channel. Then median longitudinal channel, then these three are present in the gills. So where actually the gill respiration or the respiration takes place, the exchange of gases takes place, the blood is aerated. Now aerated blood will be collected by efferent branchial channels, and from the efferent branchial channels, the blood will be carried to the pericardial sinus. This pericardial sinus, here the pericardial sinus will be there. So in the pericardial sinus, we have seen the blood enters, and from the pericardial sinus, the blood enters into the heart through the ostia. In the first slide, we have seen that there are five pairs of ostia: mid dorsal ostia, one pair of dorsal ostia, one pair of ventral ostia, one pair of posterior ostia, one pair of anterolateral ostia, and one pair of posterolateral ostia. These all ostia, they are valvular also, we have discussed, and these valvular ostia, they allow the blood into the heart from the dorsal sinus or pericardial sinus or pericardium into the heart only, but not in the reverse order. So the blood from pericardial sinus enters into the blood or heart through the all five pairs of valvular ostia, and then the cycle will be repeated again and again. So this is the course of blood circulation in prawn. Thank you.